Hello and a warm welcome to World This Week by LatestLaws.com. This is a weekly program, so hit the bell icon to get notifications for new videos. My name is Sheetal Jhun, Associate Editor, LatestLaws.com, and let's begin with Supreme Court this week. This week, the Supreme Court Constitution Bench observed that it will decide on the question of reference to a larger bench the issue surrounding Maharashtra political turmoil after hearing the matter on merits. A 5-judge Constitution Bench shall commence the hearings from February 21st. The top court had earlier reserved the judgment on the issue as to whether to refer to a larger bench for reconsideration. The 5-judge bench ruling in Mabam Rabia and Bamam Flix vs. Deputy Speaker and others. In the 2016 judgment, it was held that a speaker will be disabled from deciding disqualification petitions under the anti-defection law if a notice under Articles 179C of the Constitution for removal is pending. The political turmoil happened last year when Shiv Sena MLA Eknath Shinde turned rebel and swayed most of other MLAs to be on his side, alienating the official heads of the Shiv Sena with the remaining ones. The faction then went on to stake claims over the parties and its associated symbol, projecting themselves as the real Shiv Sena. The issue was then brought to the top court as ex-CM Uddhav Thackeray along with his supporters showed right over party's legacy while accusing Eknath of deflection. He challenged the formation of government by Eknath with the support of BJP in the state assembly. The matter was being heard by a constitution bench headed by CJ Deva Chandrachur, also comprising of Justice M.R. Shah, Justice Krishna Murari, Justice Hima Kohli and Justice P.S. Narasimha. The Uddhav Thackeray faction has sought the reference of the ruling, while Eknath Shinde's side has maintained that no reference is required. The Supreme Court has rejected Centre's suggestion presented to it in a sealed cover in the petition filed in the Adani Group and Hindenburg Research saga. A bench headed by CJ Deva Chandrachur and comprising of Justice P.S. Narasimha and Justice J.B. Paraduwala instead insisted on forming of a committee on its own for the sake of transparency. The court stated that the issue calls for complete transparency and that other side cannot be kept in dark. It is dealing with three PILs alleging exploitation of innocent investors and artificial crashing of the Adani Group's stock value after Hindenburg Research published its report and accused the group of financial irregularities and fraud. The court said that if it were to accept the suggestion, the content will be disclosed to the other party. The court also did not take kind view of the Centre's submission stating nil effect on the market as it pointed out stats which reads the investors faced a loss of lakhs of crore. The bench has reserved the verdict in the matter. The Supreme Court has closed a public interest litigation that sought a ban on the usage of the Zoom video conferencing platform. The PIL, which was filed in 2020, claiming that the app breaches users' privacy. A bench of Justice Sanjeev Khanna and Justice M.M. Sundaresh closed the petition after advocate Arvind Dattar, appearing for the Zoom, said that even the Union Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology has found nothing wrong in the use of the application. The PIL has sought a ban on the usage of Zoom app in India under the formulation of appropriate legislation, claiming that the app breaches privacy. The plea said that the platform poses a threat to the privacy of the individuals using it and also breaches cyber security. The PIL also claimed that the Zoom app is not safe because it does not have end-to-end encryption and violating the Information Technology Act 2000 and Information Technology Procedure and Safeguards for Interception, Monitoring and Description of Information Rules 2009. The CEO of Zoom Video Communications has already apologized publicly and accepted the app to be faulty in terms of providing a secure environment digitally, which is against the norms of cybersecurity, the plea stated. The Supreme Court has once again stated that high courts are not subordinate to it but are separate constitutional courts. The top court in one recent order reiterated that it is both Supreme Court and High Courts that are empowered to entertain judicial review petitions and are thus referred to as constitutional courts. The division bench made the remark while adjudicating upon an SLP seeking directions to Patna High Court to dispose of a pending writ petition within a certain period of time. The court clarified that such directives are not possible within the purview of law as High Courts are not its subordinate branch. It added that each court has different method of dealing with pending matters, stating that each court shall function on its priority basis. The court advised the petitioners that the only remedy available to them would be to apply for the respective high court requesting a priority hearing of his matter. The Supreme Court has dismissed challenge to the delimitation of assembly parliamentary seats in Jammu and Kashmir. The court added that its decision on delimitation won't have a bearing on a separate batch of matters where abrogation of Article 370 is under challenge before a constitution bench. The scraping of Article 370 giving special status to Jammu and Kashmir and bifurcation of Jammu and Kashmir into separate union territories of Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh are under challenge before the Supreme Court in separate proceedings. In December, the Modi government had told the top court that the delimitation exercise for the union territory of Jammu and Kashmir could not wait until 2026 as the idea was to give immediate democracy in the region. On May 5, 2022, the three-member delimitation commission had finalized the UP's new electoral map and earmarking 43 seats to Hindu-majority Jammu and 47 to Muslim-majority Kashmir. Thus, the strength of Jammu and Kashmir Assembly was raised from 83 to 90. Next, we have Delhi High Court. The Delhi High Court has asked the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology and Department of Telecommunications to act against the domain name registrars who are not abiding by the IT Rules 2021, notified by the government in October last year. The single judge bench of Justice Pratibha M. Singh was of the view that stringent steps would be required to be taken in order to curb the menace of illegal domain name registration having well-known marks and names of businesses' houses. Stressing that courts should focus on substantive justice, the Delhi High Court observed that in-camera proceedings can be allowed to be held in appropriate cases under Section 151 of the Civil Procedure Code. The single judge bench of Justice Chandradhari Singh remarked that it is incumbent upon the judiciary to not only see that the justice is done, but also to ensure that the justice is also seen to be done. The court thus emphasized that Section 151 CPC can be extended to allowing in-camera proceedings where deemed necessary in the interest of justice. It cited Naresh Shridhar Murajkar versus State of Maharashtra, wherein the Supreme Court mentioned slew of statutory provisions, including Section 51 CPC, deliberating how the power of the court to hold certain trials in camera, either fully or partially, is inevitably associated with the administration of justice itself. Therefore, in appropriate cases, the court may, under Section 151 of the Code, pass any order for carrying out the proceedings in camera if warranted by the facts and circumstances of the case, it stated. The Delhi High Court has ruled that Kentucky Fried Chicken, KFC, a reputed American fast food restaurant chain, has no exclusive right on the word chicken. However, the court opined that the application for registration of the mark Chicken Zinger in Class 29 can be reconsidered by the trademark registry. An application was preferred by KFC for registration of the mark Chicken Zinger. However, the said application was rejected by the senior examiner of the trademarks, hence an appeal against this was preferred. The senior examiner rejected the application, holding that the mark Chicken Zinger was descriptive of the characteristics of goods and services under which it was applied. It was ruled that the said term was not eligible for trademark as per Section 91B of the Trademarks Act 1999. In the appeal preferred before the Delhi High Court, the bench expounded that the use of Zinger along with chicken can at best be considered suggestive of the product. Further, it was observed that the subject mark has two words, Zinger and chicken. A PIL in Delhi High Court has brought up the issue of jobs being advertised at the Delhi government portal with salaries below minimum wage prescribed under labour laws. To this regard, a division bench of Chief Justice Satish Chandra Sharma and Justice Subramanian Prasad has sought the response of Delhi government of AAP. The petition has been filed by a law student who sought protection of the fundamental rights of the labourers, enforcement of labour laws and termination of the bonded labour in the National Capital Territory of Delhi. He cited violation of government order dated October 14, 2022, which fixed minimum wage per month. He also apprised the bench that he went to the Delhi government before approaching court seeking due payment of its employees, but in vain, as no action on his concern was taken by the concerned officials. The petitioner stated that the fundamental rights as guaranteed under Article 14 and 21 of the Constitution of India of the employees have been violated. Now let's have an overview of other high courts. The Bombay High Court, while allowing a writ petition filed against the judgment and order passed by the City Civil Court, whereby it had refused to condone the delay of 31 months and 16 days in filing the written statement, held that the petitioners should not be deprived of an opportunity to contest the claims on merit. A single judge bench of Justice Rajesh S. Patil observed that there is no restriction in Order 8, Rule 10, that after the expiry of 90 days, further time cannot be granted. Placing reliance on Zorba v. K. Shao and others, the court stated that the time can be extended in exceptional cases. A single judge bench of the Madras High Court dismissed a revision petition where the petitioners requested to withdraw their suit with the liberty to file a fresh suit in case of necessity and held that the suit was at the final stage and after 10 years of litigation, the petitioners cannot be permitted to withdraw the suit at their will, causing prejudice to the other side. The petitioners argued that under Order 23 Rule 13 CPC, the liberty to file a fresh suit alone cannot be rejected by the trial court and the court cannot reject the request of withdrawal. The Kerala High Court has ruled that special judge exercising jurisdiction under Prevention of Corruption Act 1988 while ordering further investigation is not empowered to direct the investigating agency to obtain sanction under Section 19 of the Act to prosecute the accused. The single judge bench of Justice K. Babu, however, observed that the investigating agency is at the liberty to take all steps to conclude the investigation and submit its report as per law, uninfluenced by the observation passed by the special judge. The court stated that it is statutory duty and responsibility of the investigating agency to fully investigate the matter and then submit a report to the court concerned, either finding the allegation substantiated or finding no material to support the allegation. The Chhattisgarh High Court has observed that Article 23 of the Indian Constitution works as a protection towards the accused against compulsory testimonial, meaning that Section 91 of the Criminal Procedure Code does not apply. The petitioners were subject to the FIR against them by the respondent under multiple sections of the Indian Penal Code. The petitioners were asked to produce certain documents under Section 91 of the Criminal Procedure Code, which would have self-incriminatory in nature. The court stated that according to Article 23 of the Constitution, no man is bound to accuse himself and that this extends to having the protection to not act as a witness against himself or provide self-incriminatory evidence. The court additionally noted that the protection would be available to a person against whom a formal charge has been lodged in the first place, as well as if such an accusation pertains to the commission of an offence that ordinarily may result in prosecution. The Gujarat High Court, while reiterating that police protection cannot be claimed as a matter of right, has rejected the petition of ex-IPS officer Sanjeev Bhatt's wife against withdrawal of a security by the state. The single judge bench of Justice Nizar Desai rejected the argument put forward by her counsel that state ought have been submitted due reasoning before withdrawal of the police protection provided to the petitioner's husband. The court stressed that the state not only withdrew Sanjeev Bhatt's security but along with him security of 64 more people and therefore the intentions of the state government cannot be questioned. The court went on to cast aspersion that if any decision in respect of police protection is directed to be placed on record, in that case there is possibility that it may expose the various modes and methods of collecting information by the state government in respect of security and threat perception about VIPs and VVIPs which may be sensitive in nature. Moving on to miscellaneous news. The Supreme Court has said that it will take a decision on the early listing of petitions challenging the center's decision to abrogate provisions of Article 370 which had given special status to Jammu and Kashmir. A bench comprising of Chief Justice D.Y. Chandrachud and Justice P.S. Narasimha and Justice J.B. Pardiwala took note of the submissions of Senior Advocate Raju Ramachandran appearing for one of the parties that the pleas needed an urgent hearing. Earlier, on April 25th and September 23rd last year, a bench headed by the then CJI N.V. Ramana, since retired, had agreed to the listing of hearing the petitions challenging the center's decision to abrogate provisions of Article 370. The Apex Court will have to reconstitute the five-judge bench to hear the petitions as ex-CJI Ramana and Justice R. Subhash Reddy, who were part of the five-judge bench which had heard the petitions, have retired. Delivering the keynote address at the inaugural session of the Delhi Arbitration Weekend organized by the Delhi International Arbitration Center, the Chief Justice of India promoted many aspects in the arbitration sphere. He batted for virtual arbitration hearing as an effective method, frequent appointment of lawyers as arbitrators, and equal opportunity to men, women, and them. In an interesting remark, he said Supreme Court is not final because it is right, but it is right because it is final, while mentioning the infamous decision of overturning of his ruling as Bombay High Court judge in ONGC versus Saw Pipes in 2003. The Supreme Court has told the taxi aggregator Uber India to apply for fresh license to run its business in Maharashtra, including Mumbai, and found that it had been operating for nearly a year on the basis of court's interim order staying the Bombay High Court's direction to it to comply with the central guidelines regulating the aggregators. A bench of CJI D.Y. Chandrachud and Justice P.S. Narasimha and Justice J.B. Pardiwala also frowned at the Maharashtra government for not framing a rule which is to be guided by the center guidelines of 2022, causing uncertainties to tax aggregators like Uber. Top mobile companies Reliance Jio, Airtel and Vodafone India complained to telecom regulator that popular OTT platforms such as WhatsApp, Facebook, Telegram, Instagram and Skype are threat to national security. They sought a regulatory and licensing regime for internet-based communications companies to ensure that they adhere to the rules and guidelines of the country. The Supreme Court of India has agreed to hear public interest litigation seeking direction to all the state governments to frame rules for menstrual pain leaves, the female students and working class women at their respective workplace and compliance of Section 14 of the Maternity Benefit Act 1961. A bench headed by CJD by Chandrachud posted the matter for hearing on February 24th. The Kerala High Court has granted relief to 10 law students who challenged the high enrollment fees charged by the State Bar Council. A single judge bench of Justice Shaji P. Chelli directed the Kerala Bar Council to accept their applications as against a fees of Rs. 750 instead of Rs. 15,900 fixed by it for time being. The petitioners, who were graduated from the Government Law College in Ernakulam, has contended that before the court that the extra fees that the Bar Council of Kerala is charging is an insurmountable financial challenge to them and many other students like them to practice the profession. It was argued by them that BKC was acting out of scope in charging a higher amount than what the provisions prescribe. In the end, we have international news. Spain's parliament has given final approval to a law allowing people over 16 to change their legally recognized gender without medical evaluation. The process to change gender on document could be in theory now take around 3 to 4 months. It also becomes the first country in the European Union to pass law on paid menstrual leave for women suffering severe period pain. Alphabet Inc.'s Google, Facebook parent Meta, Platform Inc. and Twitter to face stricter EU online content rules according to monthly users' numbers published by the companies which exceeded the EU threshold. The new rules known as the Digital Service Act labels companies with more than 45 million users as very large online platforms and subject to obligations such as risk management and external and independent auditing. They're also required to share dates and authorities and researchers and adopt a code of conduct. Switzerland has said that it is legally impossible for it to confiscate the assets of sanctioned Russians held in the country, dealing a blow to European Union's effort to use the wealth for Ukrainian post-war reconstruction. Until now, Bern has moved in line with the EU in freezing the assets of high-profile Russians connected to the regime of President Vladimir Putin. Switzerland holds more than $1.8 billion in frozen Russian assets nearly 1 year after the invasion of the Ukraine, according to the Swiss Ministry of Finance. But as calls in Europe intensify for the seizure of Russian wealth held abroad to fund Ukraine's defense and reconstruction, Switzerland has made it clear that any permanent moves against assets held in the borders would be illegal. Thank you for watching and have a nice day. This is a weekly program, and to get more information, please check the description box, and for weekly updates, like and subscribe to our channel.